So we can start this new session with Martina Dal Bello talking about from environmental responses at the organismal level to community properties, part one.
Okay. All right. Good morning. Is this thing working? Can you hear me? All right, cool. So yeah, so the idea for this... I've been kindly given 3 lectures, so you will have to see me for 3 days. Today, on Thursday and Friday. And the idea of these 3 hours together is try to, yes, go from what happens at the organismal level when microbes respond to changes in the environment and how this translates into changes into communities. All right. And now here, allow me a bit of self-advertisement. So this is actually what my lab will focus on as soon as I open it. So I'm moving from MIT to Yale in the summer, and I will start my lab. And so if you are interested in these things, and or you might know people that might like what I'm talking about, please reach out to me. And I'm hiring PhD students and postdocs and whatnot. All right, so. So here we are in a, trying to connect physiology and ecology. So here we'll try to play the ecologist of the situation. And I will try to remind you why we study microbes, why we like them so much. So basically, life on Earth depends on microbes. Microbes are everywhere. For example, we have them in our gut, and they help us digest the food that we eat and absorb nutrients from them. But also, microbes are responsible for marine and terrestrial biochemistry because they are they degrade organic matter and cycle back important nutrients to, for example, primary producers. And in doing so, they are responsible, for example, for the long-term storage of carbon. And when we think about the oceans, microbes basically produce half of the oxygen that we breathe. And in doing so, across all these ecosystems, they actually regulate the production of important greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. But the point that I want to make is that rarely all these functions depend on one bug, but actually depend on the complex network of interactions that establish among hundreds of species organized in complex communities. So really, it's good to care about single species, but also it's important to start thinking about how all these species play together in a community. And I would say that in the past few decades, with the advent of 16S amplicon sequencing, with metagenomics, we have become pretty good at understanding who these microbes are. So if I take a community in the soil and a community in the ocean, I can tell you which bugs are there, so their identity. But I think we're still struggling to understand why we see certain species in a certain part of the ocean and not in the other part of the ocean. And I think this is partly because we still need to answer one important, or at least we're trying to answering, and we're still not there yet, an important question that is, how do communities change as the environment changes? And here, when I think about the environment, we can think about, for example, temperature, salinity, nutrients, pH. And we know very well from what, for example, we've seen with Terry this morning and with other talks that all these environmental variables actually can act on the physiology of the single cell, of the organism itself. So I would say that to go from the environment or changes in the environment to community structure, what we're trying to do is actually try to understand how changes at the organismal level really scale up to tell us what happens into communities. So the plan for actually these 3 lectures is the following. Today, my idea is to start with talking about the simplest communities possible. We can even decide whether we want to call them communities, but basically those composed by 2 species. And how the outcomes of these interactions can change based on a concept that we call mortality burden, that is telling us the relationship between how you grow and how you die. And for Thursday, and this is actually setting, so today the plan is to set the stage to go to Thursday, where we will try to look at how the distribution of fast and slow growers change with, in a community, changes predictably with temperature and salinity. And I will talk specifically about marine microbes, but I think it can be extended to other systems. And finally, on Friday, the plan is to forget about temperature and salinity and go into nutrients and try to see whether we can use metabolism to try to understand how microbes assemble in communities when they grow in different resource environments. We will see where we arrive today. If we get here already, we can start moving on, because this one might be pretty long and daunting, the third one. All right, so first part. As I mentioned, we're going to look at what's the outcome of competition in the simplest communities possible in the light of mortality burden. But this mortality burden is a concept that depends on, that relies on growth rates. And actually, as we have seen, growth rate is basically a pervasive concept in ecology, not just physiology. And actually, I think that ecologists have realized that growth rate is a phenotype because so being fast or slow grower is just a possible phenotype because being faster, a faster grower is not always the best condition possible. Because, for example, when ecologists describe succession, which is the process of species colonizing, for example, an empty space, and we can think about, for example, when a fire wipes out a forest, then ecologists describe this succession, so the arrival of different species in terms of fast and slow growth. And we know that at the beginning, the species that usually colonize are faster growing species like grasses. And then as we proceed in time, the growth rate, the mean growth rate of the community decreases because we will have then bushes, and then the final state usually has a lot of trees that are slow growing species. And also, well, this concept of fast versus slow growth is pervasive in microbial ecology as well, because especially in marine environments, we distinguish between copiotrophs and oligotrophs that are usually, so the copiotrophs are usually microbes that can grow very fast and can take advantage of abundant nutrients. For example, the Vibrios that Terry was showing you today are actually usually classified as copiotrophs, while on the other side of the spectrum, we have oligotrophs that in general show slow growth rates, very slow growth rates, and usually thrive where there are less abundant nutrients. So this is just to say that this is a very pervasive concept in ecology. We can use it, so the concept of fast versus slow growth, we can use it to describe communities. But actually, the question that remains, and I think we are trying to answer, is under which conditions is it best to be a slow grower or a faster grower? Or in other words, when is the one or the other favored, depending on the environmental condition? So what I'm planning to show you today is that pairwise co-culture experiments, which means in batch, so we're not in a chemostat environment, but we are in a batch culture, allows us to study communities as the environment changes. And then I will show you that when you increase mortality, the fast growers are actually better off, but when this outcome can be reversed if you are increasing temperature in your environment, because in this case, the slower growers are actually favored. All right. So when I'm talking about these batch culture and daily dilution experiments, I mean experiments in which we can mix at different fractions two or more species. Here I'm talking about two species. And for example, these species can be different because they have different growth rates, measured, for example, in the media that we're using in the experiment. The other advantage of these daily dilution experiments is that in these flasks, or whatever 96-well plates if you're doing high throughput experiments, you can change the conditions in very consistent ways. You can change the concentration of nutrients, you can place them at different temperatures, you can shape them well, and the other thing you can manipulate is the dilution rate. So every day, or every 48 hours, depending on whatever your bugs are, sometimes you want to grow them for 24, sometimes it's best to grow them for 48 hours, you are taking a bit of the previous day culture and you are inoculating it into fresh media. And basically this simulates, so you are discarding cells, and so you're basically simulating the effect of mortality, which is another parameter that you can tune in these simple experiments. The other cool, well, convenient thing is that, well, usually these two species are growing in this media, and then you can actually count their abundances or relative abundances by plating or using a spectrophotometer or a flow cytometer. But basically, the important thing is that you can count how many cells or how many colony-forming units you have, and so you can actually get the final fraction of these communities. And I talk about final fraction because usually we do serial daily dilutions to reach a steady state. So what we're looking at is the community once it reached steady state. And since you can count abundances, you can actually have an idea of the interactions and understand who is the best competitor in that specific environment. Is that clear? Okay, all right. And the other thing is that what outcomes should we expect at the end of these serial dilution passages? Well, one possible outcome is that one species completely outcompetes the other. So here, as a function of time, so that time is usually the days you're doing the dilutions or the periods, one species, you see that here I'm plotting the fraction of one species of the two, no matter which is your starting fraction, so it can be, I don't know, 50-50, 5%, 95%, or the opposite, you always end up with this species, one species outcompeting the other, which you usually call competitive exclusion. The other outcome is that these two species can actually coexist. And here, what I'm showing you again is, as a function of time, the fraction of one species, which no matter which is the initial starting fraction, you end up at the end of these daily dilution passages to have a constant, constant coexisting fractions. And finally, there is another possible outcome that we call bistability, which means that the outcome of the competition depends on the initial fraction. So who is the winner depends on the initial fraction at which you're starting the experiment. For example, in this case, if you start with a lower fraction, this species that for which we are plotting the fraction is going down, so the other one is winning. But at a different initial fraction, here is higher, this species is actually taking over. So these are what we usually see at the end of our daily dilution experiments with two bugs. Now, here I'm plotting two bugs. The other nice thing about these experiments is that we can easily recapitulate the dynamics of the species and the outcome of competition with the Rotka-Volterra model. So Rotka-Volterra model has been proposed by Rotka and Volterra several, I would say 100 years ago, more or less, and described the dynamics of two populations. Originally, it was proposed to describe predator-prey dynamics, if you remember the hare and the fox. What was the other one? The hare and the fox. The lynx, thank you. Well, one predator and the other one was a prey. But it has been extended also to recapitulate the outcome of competition. So here, the equations are pretty simple. We have the per capita growth rate that depends on the growth rate of the species, the maximum growth rate of the species. And then we take into account a self-inhibition term that is telling us basically how much your kinds, so your conspecifics are inhibiting your growth. And also there is basically how much the other competing species is inhibiting your growth. And this is exemplified by a dimensionless parameter that is the inhibition coefficient. And the interpretation of this model, so the outcome, and of course you have one equation for species one and one equation for species two, but this model can be extended to many, many species. But for the moment, we keep it simple. Actually, so the outcome of the competition certainly depends on the alpha coefficient, so the inhibition coefficients. In this simple way, if we plot, this is a space where we have the logarithm of the alpha to 1, which is inhibition of species 2 by species 1. And on this other axis, on the x-axis, we have the inhibition of species 1 of species 2. We can see that we have full coexistence when both coefficients are smaller than 1. We have bistability with both coefficients are larger than 1. And you can have either dominance of one species or exclusion or the same species, whether one of the two coefficients is, one is larger than one and one is smaller than one. And these are all analytical solutions. So for this model actually recapitulates perfectly all the possible outcomes that we see in species, in co-culture experiments. So the question that then you can ask is, okay, if I'm thinking about the environment, what changes due to the environment can happen and can be actually recapitulated in this model? Well, for example, one possible thing that you can think about is, well, maybe there is environmental deterioration. And just to give you an idea, a common form of environmental deterioration is an increased mortality. And let's think about like overfishing. If you have a population of fish, you are going there with your big boats, you are removing a lot of fishes, and what happens is that you are applying, let's say, a mortality that is global. So everyone is more or less, so on you, the mortality that is arriving on you is basically similar across all species. And actually the outcome we know, for example, for several communities, for example, communities in the Terranova banks where the many species has been wiped out, is that the outcome of this increased mortality is a change in community structure. So one question that we can try to ask in these simple systems is how do changes in mortality affect the outcome of two species competition? And the good thing is that in these simple experiments, as if you remember before, we have a simple way of manipulating mortality. So when we do these daily dilutions, we are actually discarding a fraction of cells. And how much you are diluting? Yes.
In this kind of mortality, you are removing the population from the reactor or the sea. But there's another kind of mortality where you kill them and they actually release nutrients, which would give a very different outcome,
yeah,
probably.
I agree. Yeah, this is mortality when you just wipe out the population and there is nothing for you to gain if you are the other species. And also in this system, especially if you're growing them every 24 hours, actually you rarely see people dying. So the nutrients that they're actually exposed to are usually nutrients that we provide or that are produced by cross-feeding, but I don't want to get into this now, during the growth rate, whether it's exponential or in steady state. Yeah. Over many cycles. So with the Lotka-Volterra, we're actually looking at steady state dynamics, not at the transient. So actually, you arrive at the steady state. That's why, so the serial dilution is actually to be sure that you're not in a transient state, but you're looking at the final state of the community that is stable. You kill most of them every time, but basically you, every time you reach a stable population, and so you ensure that who is actually surviving, so that survives who is actually surviving the mortality, so the dilution rate. Let's say if you grow less than your mortality, you're deterministically wiped out. If you grow more than the mortality, then you can survive, but then the outcome, so who is winning, actually depends on several things. Mostly the competition coefficients, but the competition coefficients depends on your growth rate and how you actually are competing against mortality, which is where I'm going, basically. Does it? No. Okay. All right. As I was saying, so basically in these experiments, you can simulate this global mortality where you're not killing cells, you're just eliminating them from the population. And you can survive in this system only if your growth rate is actually higher than the mortality rate. So now we can go back to this. And actually, one question is that usually when you are competing these species, you might have a species that is growing faster than the other in a certain condition that you are analyzing. So, and it's pretty easy to add mortality rate to lot cover terra models, and specifically this mortality that we're adding that wants to simulate what we're doing in the experiments is this constant, so it's a constant fraction of cells that you are removing at each dilution rate. And you can do some reparametrization of the model to absorb mortality. I don't think it's super important to go into the math, but basically what this reparametrization allows you to do is to write the competition coefficients. Here I wrote the competition coefficient, so this is the inhibition of the slow species by the fast species, which is just a function of the mortality and the growth rate. So basically how you are surviving in this system depends on this ratio between mortality and growth rates. And I call this actually, we can call this ratio a mortality burden, which is telling us basically how good you are at outcompeting mortality, which is fixed, or can change, and depends on how fast you grow. I think it should be pretty intuitive. So if you grow fast enough to overcome mortality, you can survive. But then when you actually look at the competition, so the competition coefficient, so how much you are good at inhibiting the other species, depends exactly on how good you are outcompeting mortality. All right? Yes.
Dilution, you would just keep the fractions the same, right?
Well, once you reach steady state, you keep the fractions the same.
Yeah, but if you just take a random sample and put it in new medium, you expect the same fractions before and after, right?
Well, you expect, yes. So you start with your populations, they reach a certain fractions, and then you dilute. And then so you start with this initial fraction. So it's basically, so the idea of the redilution is actually to end up with a stable fraction. So once you actually don't change the fractions, it means that the population is stable. But at the beginning, you can have changes because they might grow in different ways. And you are, when you are removing them, they arrive at a certain fraction, and then you're diluting at that fraction.
Okay. So doesn't have mortality have to have a term that's multiplied by n?
Yeah. This is actually, so the n is dividing everything.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
Oh, no problem. Yeah. So n is actually multiplying r and multiplying n, but you can.
Yeah, no, I get it.
Okay, cool. Right. all right, so the idea is that these competition coefficients only depend on growth rate and mortality. And the thing is that we can actually if we go back to our previous plot, we can see that we can still plot in the same way, where actually we can go in this section, since we are calling species one the slower grower is winning, the fast grower is winning, and here we have bistability and coexistence. So actually in this model, the cool thing is that it is possible for a slow grower to outcompete a fast grower when mortality is sufficiently low. Then, as we increase mortality, what we're doing, I think it's a good way to visualize this, is that you're moving through this phase, through this space by 45 degrees. So let's say if you start here and you are, and here the slow grower is winning and we are at low mortality rate, if we increase mortality, we can either cross a coexistence region and then end up with a faster growing winning, or if we are, for example, here, with here I mean the relationship between the two competing coefficients, you can still have the slower growing winning, cross a region of bistability, and then end up with the fast grower winning. And this is all this is how the growth rate is affecting, the mortality rate is affecting these ratios and affecting, therefore, the relationship between competition coefficients. I see many perplexed faces. Okay, let's do this. Let's look at the experiment. No, tell me.
So there's a difference between the growth rate that's realized, that's sort of a net growth rate of all of these processes.
But you're thinking about seeing the one period. During one period, if you are actually making to the second step, it means that you are growing faster than the other one at a certain point. But over longer periods, you can be a slow grower on average, so across different mortality rates, but at low dilutions, these ratios, in these ways, ensure that you're still outcompeting the fast grower. But as soon as you are increasing mortality, the fast grower becomes better at outcompeting mortality itself, and so becomes a better competitor.
I think, yeah, that makes sense. And I think, the math is undeniably the same. The confusion for me is that it says slow grower wins, because there's this intuition that to win at some instant in time, you need to have a higher growth rate. And I think there's two growth rates here. There's like an instantaneous growth rate that's basically defined
by... this is your maximum growth rate. So the thing that is defining you as the slow grower or the fast grower is your maximum growth rate. Over the cycle, so when you're actually growing in these 24 hours, there are differences in growth rates.
Okay,
but
I think, yeah.
Let's say if I'm measuring growth rate in this condition, in this growth media, you can be always lower than me. I can always be faster than you with my maximum growth rate. But as I change mortality, even if this relationship doesn't change, you can outcompete me at low mortality, and I can outcompete you at higher mortality.
Because at some instant in point, the effective growth rate that you have.
But they are both surviving over the cycle, yes.
Okay, maybe let's figure this out in the break. But I thank you.
All right. Yes.
When you say increase mortality rate, that also can be done with diluting.
We are doing it with dilution.
Yes. So the more I dilute, the more the fast grower wins.
Yes.
Okay.
That's the idea.
Can you say why it is not a problem that there's one constant mortality rate instead of this serial dilution that you're actually doing?
The mortality rate is actually exemplifying these dilutions. It's constant because you're always removing the same fraction of cells. Then the fraction of cells that you are removing can have different fractions of the two species. Yeah, no, no. Okay, so this is a chemostat. It's a chemostat model. But actually, if you do like the batch culture model, it doesn't really change. So the thing here is that you can approximate a chemostat model to a batch culture, or at least that's our yes.
Yeah, I have sort of a more of a comment than a question, because from the previous questions, I can see that people are confused about the slower species winning over the fast species. But the reason why it wins is because there is a strong suppression of the growth of the fast species by the slower species.
Yeah.
So in other words, those interaction terms is what makes the slower species to win. If they don't interact, of course, the fast species will always overtake. If you set your alphas to zero, then no question. That you are in.
Yes. What I'm saying is that this affects the competition coefficient. So actually,
right.
Yeah, exactly what you're saying. Yeah. Thank you. So this is the way to see how this actually competition coefficient changes. And so in this region, competition coefficient for the fast grower is less than one, and the other one is larger than one, and so that is why the fast grower is winning.
Yeah,
okay, in terms of numbers, like how does the mortality, the dilution rate or mortality rate in your experiments compared to the growth rate of the fast and the grower, slow growing species? Because I mean, from that expression, if the dilution rate is the same rate as the slow growing species, the interaction coefficient should explode basically. So if the slow growing species has a growth rate of 0.3 per hour and the fast 1 per hour, like.
Can I show you the data?
Okay, yes.
experiments. All right. So, for example, this is growth rate of two species. This is Enterobacter aerogenes, formerly known Enterobacter aerogenes, I think now is Klebsiella, possibly. You can see that it's a faster grower compared to these other Pseudomonas species, so it reaches saturation before the other species. And now we're doing an experiment with a dilution factor of 10, which means that I'm transferring 1/10 of the previous day culture into the new culture, which is a quite low dilution rate. And you can see that over the course of time here, I'm plotting the fraction of the fast grower, so the red guy. You can see that over the course of time, these daily dilution passages at the end, the fast grower is actually outcompeted and the slow grower is winning. So this is how, okay. Maybe I don't have the actual number for the growth rate, but I can take them. So the dilution factor is 10. So mortality would be 0.1. Yes. So?
Why is it saturating OD so low?
Because it's not in rich medium. This is in minimum.
So are you putting, no, rich or not has to do with the speed, but the saturation
but also probably it has to do with volume.
How much nutrient you're putting. Are you putting a very low amount?
Yeah, it's not high. I think it's 0.1 or 0.2.
Does the result change if you?
I think, yeah. I mean, if you increase the concentration, they would grow to higher ODs. Yeah, it's not, yeah, no, I agree. But it's a minimal media and with not too much carbon in it. I don't exactly, it might be like 0.1 or 0.2% weight per volume. No, the other two, it should be M9 or another medium, so you're not limited by nitrogen and phosphorus, but they can be carbon limited. Even though they...
Do you understand in this case why the fast growers?
We think it's because of this mechanism we were thinking about before, that the slow grower is actually inhibiting more because it's able to grow, and So it depends on the relationship Gabo showed you.
Yeah, so within the lock of a terror, as Leonardo was asking, Sergey was commenting, you would need to propose some a negative interaction of a slow growth on a fast growth. But do you know?
No, I know. I don't know exactly what they are doing.
But no, there could be many other.
Yeah, it could be many other things.
You get exponential growth during dilution, during the growth period?
I think so, but.
This is a single species.
Yeah, no, this is, these are single species. Yeah, I don't know. I don't think.
During co-culture.
I don't think they had the data about co-culture. I don't know. I can check them.
Co-culture is also at this very low nutrient level.
I can check. It shouldn't be that much more, but we can check. I don't remember now. All right. Okay, so, no.
Sorry, one more quick question. So I totally understood this whole thing when Sergey explained it. And so, but that means a corollary of that is that this should not be generic, because in some cases, some species won't inhibit, the slow grower won't inhibit the fast grower and so on.
But I think that the reason why we're not going to mechanisms, because it doesn't necessarily have to inhibit. It can be better at consuming the resource.
But all these things are contingencies, right? There may be this may work 50%, 50%
of the time.
Yeah, they
are contingencies, but they happen quite often. So, which means that even though you don't know you don't exactly know the mechanism, except that you are growing at a certain rate, you are either growing faster compared to more. So you have this relation between mortality and growth rate. The mechanism for which they are inhibiting each other, we don't really care about it. We're not asking how, but it's sufficiently, I would say, generic that no matter what they're doing, it happens.
It's not about the exact mechanism. It's that there is an inhibition. That's what I mean. Sounds like it could sometimes be, maybe sometimes there.
What I'm saying is that it's an interaction, and I'm not putting a label on the type of interaction. I don't know the type of interaction, actually.
I just want to comment here that the interaction must be necessarily not through resource competition, because if they're competing for a single resource.
No, it's not a single resource.
It's not. It's a rich medium. Then, of
it's
course.
It's not a rich medium. It can be. You can do it in rich medium. You can do it in two resources. You can do it in one resource, and it doesn't change.
So then the inhibition must be through pH or whatever other mechanism.
It's buffered.
Well, then it's a bit of a mystery, because if you kind of look at your growth curves, it should be independent of the dilution factor. The fact that the red one has faster exponential growth, that should give you a dominant effect of the red one, if it's only talking about competition for resources. So something else must be going on.
I don't know how they're.
Right. I think we can move.
But what I want to show you is that these were experiments done with five species. And they showed that basically, predictably, you can always establish when you do pairs, one species that is slower growing compared to the other one. And as you increase dilution rate, here I'm going, you can, for example, these two species, that is these Enterobacter erogenes and Pseudomonas veroni, you can cross the coexistence region, and you can end up with the Pseudomonas veroni winning as you increase mortality. But you can also have the other possibility, that is, here we have again Pseudomonas veroni, but it's a slower grower compared to another species, that is Pseudomonas citronellolis, possibly. And here you start always with Pseudomonas veroni winning at lower dilution rate, but you cross the bistability region, in which the winner depends on the initial fraction, and finally you can end up with the faster grower winning. What I'm saying is that you cannot believe the model, you cannot believe the mechanism. This is the data. Yes.
1 second.
I knew I wouldn't finish the hour.
Okay, look.
Good question. Good question. I think that you can reproduce these models if you actually look at like growth with lag time. I think Jacopo can tell you more about this.
Between these two, what did you do?
What do I do? Those are different species. Yeah.
What's the dilution rate? I mean, the
so you go like 10, 100, 1,000, or maybe so the dilution is dilution factor. Yes. No, you don't change from time. You do one run at 10, one run at 100, and one run at 1,000. Yes. No, but you're always 24 hours. So
it, yeah, you're always 24, but you have a lot, if there's a thousand for that, you have a lot, you'll be growing for much longer.
I think there's a lot to do. There's a lot to do.
But then you would test.
Of course. I'm an experimentalist, I believe the data, then we use a phenomenological model to try to understand what's going on. But I think that at the end of the day bothers me is that these predictions, whatever you do mortality, you do temperature, you do salinity, you always get the same things. So maybe the model is completely wrong, but it's helping us actually making predictions that then we can test. And when we test them, they turn out to be true with the data. I don't care about the models, honestly. Single species, okay, I don't know. So this is not my data, actually. This was trying to set up the stage to arrive at my data at a certain point. Okay. But yeah. These are all interesting things that we don't know, actually, and so I think that one can explore for, hopefully for the next 7 years, which is my tenure track. Anyway, I'm kidding, okay. All right, so. Indeed. Anyway, so again, I think that the main takeaway here is that the model is a phenomenological model, so it doesn't have any mechanism attached. It's just trying to understand the dynamics. And actually what we see is that, to me, the most important thing is that you can modulate the outcome of the competition by modulating mortality. Which is and by modulating the environment, let's say this. All right. So the question is, can we actually predict something harder? So can we actually predict how temperature can affect competition? Again, temperature is, so what time is it? How much do I have?
If we count the number of questions, you have like 45 minutes. No, I'm joking.
No,
I think we can go for 10 minutes.
Okay, cool. Then it's what I need. All right, so temperature we've seen is, everyone knows is a cardinal variable of life, and also especially microbial life, because bugs are not able to regulate their internal temperature. And this is taken from, a basic microbiology book, and it shows that each bacterium has a specific growth curve as a function of temperature, and it has a minimum temperature at which it can grow. Below that temperature, you can have membrane gelling, so some transporters cannot work anymore, and so the species cannot grow. Then you have growth rate is increasing rapidly because temperature is actually increasing the rate of enzymatic reactions. And then at a certain point, you reach an optimum, and we've seen that you can grow species at the optimum temperature. And then above the optimum, then you start having all these problems. Protein starts to denaturate, and then you have the collapse of the membranes. You can have lysis, so bad, you die. The other interesting thing is that we have microbes actually can literally explore the range of temperatures that we have on our planet, because they can grow at very different temperatures, meaning that they have very different optima. We've seen this morning that, for example, Vibrio nitrogens likes 37 degrees, Bacillus likes a higher temperature, but these bugs are actually all mesophiles. They like this range of temperature between 10 and 50 degrees, but then you can go, there are some species that really like the cold, and others that instead can reach, like, they grow best at like 100 degrees Celsius, so they thrive in these crazy environments that, for example, thermal springs. So let's say we stay in the realm of mesophiles, that is what we can grow in the lab, and we can ask, okay, at a certain temperature, which species is going to benefit in our experiments? Here, I'm showing you the result of a co-culture experiment. Same experiments as before, we mix two species, we mix them at different fractions. The species for, if you are interested, are two species isolated from soil. They're pretty easy to grow, they like everything. We grow them in these minimal medium plus carbon sources. And we see that at this intermediate temperature, that is 25 degrees, they coexist. They reach this stable fraction, they like each other. At this, we can actually measure the maximum growth rate at these two temperatures. And we see that the red guy is growing faster than the blue guy. And actually, there is almost a twofold difference in their maximum growth rate. Despite that, they coexist. But I leave it there. So the question is, and here I'm plotting the fraction of the blue guy. And what we will see in the next two plots is the fraction of the blue guy. What happens if we increase temperature? Well, very predictably, because we've just seen the curves before, both species increase their growth rate. So both the red guy and the blue guy, going from 16 degrees to 30 degrees, see an increase in their growth rate. But the red guy is actually increasing its growth rate much more. The increasing growth rate is usually higher compared, increases, like the, sorry, the proportion, the difference between the two growth rate increases as we increase temperature. And now you can ask, okay, if I compete these two species at this temperature at which I measure growth rate, what's the outcome of the competition? Well, here at lower temperature, the blue guy is outcompeted by the fast grower, but I would say you might say surprisingly, the slow grower is outcompeted the fast grower at the highest temperature, even though there is still a difference in temperature, in growth rates, and this difference in growth rate is actually favoring the fast grower. Then I'm trying to get the approach that we were telling before. So what can happen when we increase temperature? Well, for example, higher temperatures can activate the antibiotic production in some species. Or we've seen, for example, there was a poster yesterday, I think it was Benjamin, that you can actually induce thermal lysis by a phage if you increase temperature. So all these possible things can happen when you increase temperature. But actually, one thing that we can do in our simple phenomenological model that we can believe or not believe, is we can allow growth rate to change as a function of temperature. So here, this is the same model that we've seen before. We still have mortality because we're still trying to understand what's going on in these daily dilution experiments in which I'm imposing a fixed mortality rate. This thing is not changing across experiments. The only thing that's changing is the growth rate, and we can try to model, so implement growth rates in this model as a function of temperature. And here I'm just reminding you what we can do. We can always do this reparametrization in which the competition coefficient only depends on the ratio between mortality and growth rates. that's a good point, but I think it can, so if you're actually increasing growth rates, so what I'm saying is that your inhibition still depends on your growth rate. Which, and if your growth rate is changing with temperature, also your inhibition factor, which is the whole point of this thing, is also changing with temperature. Yes, they are both mesophiles. It's kind of, it's the same, yeah.
So it's not like one is already equal.
No. So this actually, this is an important point. We are, and I was about to arrive there, we are within the thermal limits below the optimum. The thing is just that this is how in the model you can change the growth rates. So this is how, so increase in temperature, and this is how, for example, you, the maximum growth rate change. And one important thing that I want to show you, just to make you understand a bit more this concept, is that this ratio, which depends on mortality, which is fixed, and growth rate that are changing, this is how it changes for the fast grower and the slow grower as temperature increases. Yeah. Yeah, Simon measured like all the growth rate at different temperatures, and they were not in the collapsing phase. So actually, the thing that I the point that I can make really quickly probably is that you can model these dependence on temperatures in two ways. You can have, maybe I can go there. This is Arrhenius, and you are assuming that you know there is. Linear dependence between growth rate and the inverse of temperature. And so basically you can say that the growth rate is a function of, again, it's an exponential function of the activation energy, the Boltzmann constant, and the temperature in K. And the way you are, you can multiply each growth rate by a certain factor to distinguish between a fast and a slow grower. But you can actually do it in a different way. So in this paper that is published, actually Simon and Claire used a different model, the Ratkowski model. It's actually slightly more complex, but fits the temperature curves much better. And here, growth rate as a function of temperature depends on the slope of the square root of the growth rate versus temperature, and you take into account this minimal growth temperature. But the point is, no matter the way you are including the dependence on temperature of growth rate. Let's say the outcome of this model shows that, so here just to remind you what the increased mortality rate was doing, so shifting the outcome from this quadrant where the slow growers win to this quadrant where the fast growers wins. Temperature is doing the opposite, so it's shifting back the outcome of the competition towards the slower grower winnings. So if you are at a certain dilution rate here, you keep the dilution rate fixed, but you increase the temperature, the outcome of the competition is that the slower grower is going to win. And this is because this is how this mortality burden is affecting the competitive coefficients. And so in this quadrant here, the slow grower is inhibiting more the fast grower. Okay. So how often does it happen in our pairwise co-cultures? Quite often. So these are, before I showed you the results of two pairs, of one pair, that was the plots that I showed you before. But in this heat map, I'm plotting the fraction of the slow grower. And you see that if you move from 16 degrees, that is the lowest temperature that that Simon and Claire looked at, you generally see that the relative abundance of the slow grower increases as temperature increases. So it's a pretty like widespread phenomenon. All right, so I think I can just wrap up here. And well, maybe I convinced you that pairwise co-culture experiments are a nice playground to look at how the environment can change the outcome of competition. And I hope that at least the data convinced you that if you increase mortality, you're favoring fast-growing species. And this is all relative. And instead, increased temperature can reverse this effect and actually favor slow growers. The plan is that I'll show you that for temperature, this is actually possibly true in natural microbiomes. And for today, I guess we can stop here.